pleasure and honor, a little scary to follow such wonderful speakers who know so much about the history of the war and history more generally. And this museum, I've never been here before. I should have come here before while I was doing research on the book. But it's really quite a stupendous place. Most of you have probably been here before. I haven't. I mentioned to some people the Smithsonian, the National Museum of American History in New York, excuse me, in Washington, where I live, has a rather large and pretty good exhibit on the history of Americans at war. People have probably seen that. But if you've seen it, it's kind of hard to find World War I there. You know, it's sort of squirreled into a little case, you know, sort of in between Spanish-American War and World War II. Almost as if they said, well, yeah, you know, we have to have something on World War I. They have a poster, you know, of course, the flag poster, Uncle Sam Wants You. They have a doughboy's helmet. They have, I think, a machine gun. You know, it's really kind of an afterthought. In fact, one time I was there, I heard a child, a boy, maybe 10 years old, say to his mother, there were two world wars? I didn't know that. And you could, you know, be, it's easy if you see that exhibit to miss this one. Now, I realize I am the only thing standing between you and the cocktail hour. So I will try to, you know, keep you interested by saying some provocative things. And also, you know, we've heard some wonderful lectures today about the war and hear more about it yesterday. What I'm going to talk about today really is the anti-war. I'm not a historian of World War I. If I were, I would have been here before. And I'm not a military historian either. I'm a historian of social movements and politics, as Laura mentioned. However, I should say I have a little credibility on the war because my first cousin twice removed is Barbara Tuchman. And every summer until I was about 15 years old, my grandmother was allowed by Barbara to use a house on Barbara's rather large estate in Cascade, Connecticut. So, and whenever I tried to talk to Barbara, she was always working on another book. So, but The Guns of August is one of the first serious history books I ever read, and one of the things which really influenced me to become a historian, I think, after a while. So at least I have that going for me. Well, I want to begin this talk by showing you photos of four leaders of the largest and most sophisticated opposition to any war in U.S. history until the Vietnam War. None of these people is known to most Americans. This is the only figure, I think, who's known even to most historians, except for those who focus very precisely on this period. But each of these figures was the leader of a major segment of this anti-war movement, this peace coalition, I think is a better way to put it, because it involved people in Congress and outside Congress, one of the reasons it was as powerful and influential as it was. Robert La Follette, a name probably most of you know, senator from Wisconsin, very progressive Republican, really the intellectual, motivational leader, if you will, of progressive Republicans in the Congress, especially from the Midwest. By the way, one of his disciples, so to speak, was the chair of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, William Stone, who was from Missouri. And La Follette and Stone were two of the six senators to vote against the declaration of war in early April 1917. The other three figures, you know, if you know them, more power to you, but most people, I don't think, do not. Chris Leisman was a feminist, a pacifist, a socialist. She was very active in the suffrage movement. She also, before World War I began, was active in New York City in convincing auto companies to let women sell cars to women, something which, you know, wasn't done before 1913. So she was important as a sort of commercial forerunner as well. Chris Leisman was the leader of two of the largest and most important anti-war organizations during World War I in the United States. The Women's Peace Party of New York City, it was headquartered in Chicago. The titular head of the Women's Peace Party was Jane Addams, the great writer and pacifist and social worker. But the largest detachment of it was in New York City, and Crystal Eastman was the leader of that. And also she was the secretary, that is the leader of the American Union Against Militarism, which was a national organization and was involved in making connections with Congress, both with Democrats and Republicans in Congress, who opposed preparing for the war, who opposed building up the army and building up the navy in case war would come, and then opposed both going to war and conscription. Mars Hillquit, a immigrant from Latvia, Riga, Latvia, who's the international secretary of the Socialist Party of the United States. This, as some of you probably know, was the only period, really, when socialism seemed to be going somewhere in America. Socialist Party had over 100,000 members. It had newspapers, hundreds of newspapers all over the country. It was able to win up to 16% of the vote in states like Oklahoma and Nevada. And Hillquit spoke many languages. He was in close touch with socialists, both those who supported the war in Europe and who opposed the war. And he wrote every important statement by the Socialist Party from 1914 to 1917, and also the important statements the Socialist Party put out after the socialists, unlike most socialists in Europe, decided to oppose going to war. Also in 1917 in the fall, he ran for mayor of New York on an anti-war platform, and for a while the Wilson administration thought he would actually win. He did not win, he came in a close third, but he won almost 25% of the vote on an anti-war platform during the war. Give you some sense of how unpopular the war was, at least in certain parts of the country, once the U.S. was already in it. And finally, a man named Claude Kitchen, Southern Democrat from northeastern North Carolina, 2nd District of North Carolina. He was the majority leader of the House and also chair of the Ways and Means Committee, the Tax Writing Committee. So he had his fingers on, or his hands on, all the revenue-creating measures, both before the war and during the war, which is a key position, of course, in any war, decide whether the military, how to raise the money for the war, or try to stop raising the money for the war, if that's what you want to do. Now, at the start, one misconception about those who oppose the war, I want to clear up right away. That is that Americans who opposed the war were isolationists. They wanted nothing to do with the rest of the world. They wanted to stay safe behind the ocean borders the United States had. They might care what happened in Mexico, maybe what happened in Canada, but you know, what happened in Europe was a world away. They wanted to stay away from that war. The United States, as you know, had never fought a war in Europe. And so they wanted to just sort of stay away from it. And this is supposedly what motivated people in the anti-war movement. Well, it was one of the things which motivated some Americans, certainly, to want to stay out of the war. That's undeniable. But it did not motivate these four or other leaders and prominent figures in the anti-war movement that I could mention. All these figures, Kitchen a little less so, but certainly La Follette and Eastman and Hillquit, were deeply involved with pacifists, feminists, and often socialists in Europe. They agreed with those who opposed the war in Europe that the only way to finally end war was to build a just order, the kind of thing Woodrow Wilson also talked about. But most of these figures wanted to go farther than Wilson. They wanted to build what they called a socialized democracy. They wanted to build peaceful cooperative relationships between national states. They wanted, in effect, a League of Nations before Wilson himself talked about a League of Nations. But they wanted a League of Nations which would be distinguished by a much more left-wing polity, a much more left-wing economic and social policy. And also, there's another misconception about the war, which is that, you know, most Americans want to stay out of it. There was not, you know, of course, it was hard to get the U.S. into the war until the Germans resumed unrestricted U-boat warfare in February 1917 because, you know, not that many people really wanted to get into the war. That's not true. There are some rather powerful, well-financed people and groups that might not have wanted to get into the war right away, but they wanted to prepare for it, and once opinion changed enough, they would have wanted to get the U.S. To declare war. You've heard of this guy here. The former president Theodore Roosevelt continued to be one of the most popular Americans, a great progressive as well as, I think it's fair to say, a war lover. He's sitting with various figures, of course, some in uniform, some not, at a rally for the National Security League, formed in 1915, which was a major lobby for first preparedness, for enlarging the Army, enlarging the Navy, and also for military training. Supported what was called the Plattsburgh Movement, which tried to get young men, especially upper middle class and upper class young men, to do military training, tried to pass laws in various cities around the country to public schools to have young men or boys drill during school hours. ROTC was an idea that came out of this preparedness movement as well. And they wanted to, build up U.S. forces to have an army large enough to take on the Japanese, which was thought to be a threat, perhaps invading California, and of course, to take on the Germans. And they wanted a Navy second to none as well. Now, one of the conceptions about the war and about what Americans thought about the war is certainly true. When the war began, not many Americans wanted to get into it. And Woodrow Wilson spoke for the large majority of Americans. It's pretty clear. When, in the middle of August 1914, he said this: "We must be impartial in thought as well as action, must put a curb upon our sentiments as well as upon every transaction that might be construed as a preference of one party to the struggle before another." He urged Americans to stay neutral in thought as well as deed. Otherwise, he thought, the U.S. would not be able to be a fair mediator. He wanted, at some point, he kept saying, really throughout the 2.5 years after the war began in August, up until the time when the U.S. declares war itself, he wanted to mediate the war. He wanted to somehow be the honest broker between the Central Powers and the Entente. He had, great ambitions to be the great statesman. And of course, as someone who believed very much in the promise of American democracy, he wanted to spread that around the world. But for a long time, he wanted to do it peacefully. And also, he was quite aware that there were tremendous amount of ethnic tensions boiling up once the war began. The German-American Alliance, who had 2 million members, supported by the brewing interests, in America. It was holding demonstrations in many cities were strong with Germans, like St. Louis and Milwaukee and New York City, Chicago, calling for the U.S. to stay out and really basically supporting the German war aims. And there were Poles who were arguing that Poland should have its independence and the war would mean nothing if that couldn't happen. There were Russian Jews who very much opposed the Tsar and in some ways supported the Germans because of that, because the Tsar was the greatest anti-Semite in the world. On the other hand, there were Russian Christians who wanted to support their soldiers, so to speak, in their own land, fighting against the Germans. So this was also one of the motivations of Wilson to try to make comments like this. In fact, he convinced the mayor of New York, a guy named John Pryor Mitchell, to halt all demonstrations in sympathy with either side in August 1914. Mitchell, a good Democrat, a member of Wilson's party, was quite willing to do that. It was in the interest of national security to do this. However, through the diplomatic policies he chose to adopt, I think Wilson undermined his own neutral rhetoric. And this is controversial, and we can hope to talk about this during the question period. I think Wilson's policies made U.S. intervention on the side of the Allies probable, if not inevitable, because he did nothing to compel American business to stay neutral, either in thought or deed. By early 1915, J.P. Morgan and Company had become the sales agent for the British, taking 1% commission on everything that the British bought in the U.S. American food, American steel were keeping the British war effort going, at least in part. And all that aid helped lift the U.S. out of a serious recession. Unemployment rate was roughly 10 or 11% in 1913. By 1915, it had been cut in half. So Wilson's choice to threaten a war over one side's violation of neutral rights, that is Germany's U-boat warfare, and not the other side's, that is Britain's naval blockade that we heard a wonderful lecture about right before, had a fateful consequence. Given the superiority of the British Navy on the North Atlantic, the Germans, I think not, you know, irrationally believed that submarine warfare was the only effective military response they could make to the blockade. So one could argue it may have been just a matter of time before U-boat attacks provoked the U.S. Into declaring war. Of course, Wilson's decision was not an irrational one. The North Atlantic, unlike the North Sea, was a lifeline for U.S. commerce. To destroy neutral ships, to kill neutral Americans, was a violation of existing international law. Not that the British blockade wasn't violating the rather vague and spongy statutes of global jurisprudence as well. One of the quips made at the time about the British blockade versus U-boat warfare was, Britannia rules the waves and waves the rules. But Woodrow Wilson was not himself neutral in thought. He was a lifelong Anglophile. His mother had been born in Great Britain. His greatest political heroes were Edmund Burke and William Gladstone. And the Lake District was his favorite place on earth. Less than a month after Europeans went to war, he told Colonel Edward House, his closest advisor, "A German victory, quote, will change the course of our civilization and make the United States a militaristic nation." So in January 1917, Wilson gives this incredibly eloquent, perhaps naively eloquent speech, calling on both sides to make a peace with that victory. By that time, as we know and we just heard, the Germans had already made their decision to resume unrestricted U-boat warfare. But as much as he wished the U.S. could remain neutral, as much as he wished the U.S. could, you know, be an honest broker between the different sides, Wilson, I think, could not really choose not to care who won the war. If the Germans won the war, it would be an utter disaster from his point of view. But millions of Americans did view with alarm the idea of either side winning the war and viewed the mounting bloodshed of the war, both on the Western and Eastern fronts, with alarm. They opposed the preparedness crusade. They opposed then the decision to move towards going to war and then the decision to go to war. And a concerned minority organized, as I said, the largest, most diverse, I think also most sophisticated peace movement to that point in U.S. history. And it was a very broad movement. Really, it's hard to think of any particular segment of the American population, except perhaps British people from British background, especially in the Northeast, who didn't have some representatives in this anti-war coalition at different times. There were people from the East, from the South, from the West. There was no region that was particularly strong pro-war or anti-war. And it was begun by women, by feminists. In fact, it was a feminist cause at the beginning. August 29th, 1914, a group of pretty wealthy white Protestant advocates for women's rights, international arbitration, took the lead in the movement. They held a march down Fifth Avenue in Manhattan. About 1,500 women, many dressed in black, of course, to symbolize mourning. No national flags were allowed to be flown of any kind, even the American flag. They wanted to show, again, this international consciousness, this international solidarity, if you will, of women especially. 10 times as many New Yorkers massed along both sides of Fifth Avenue. It was huge news all over the country. The leader of it was a woman named Fanny Garrison Villard. Her middle name, should tell you something. She was the daughter of William Lloyd Garrison, one of the most important abolitionists in American history. And she said this way, she described it this way. She said, "I was more than surprised at the reverential attitude of the spectators. It was only a feeble effort, really. We have simply cast a pebble into the water. But I hope there may be ever-widening circles that perhaps will make men realize what a crime it is to send thousands of husbands and fathers and sons to a useless slaughter. And this was the tone that Garrison Villard and many other feminists like Crystal Eastman continued to take, really, throughout the course of the war. And the circles she mentioned did widen, and they widened rather quickly. That fall, two charismatic European feminists from belligerent nations, a woman named Rosika Schwimmer from Hungary and Emmeline Pethick Lawrence from Great Britain, lectured in several American cities and inspired women in these cities to establish peace committees, as they were called. By the way, Pethick Lawrence is Pethick-Lawrence. I should have gotten a slide of her. It was unusual at that time because her maiden name was Pethick. Her husband's name was Lawrence. She decided to have a hyphenated name, which was, now we sort of get used to that. But then it was really kind of a radical thing to do. In January, these women's committees, peace committees, came together in the largest gathering of women in a, you know, a convention in American history to that date. They formed the Women's Peace Party, 3,000 women, at the Willard Hotel right next to the White House. The delegates included nearly every prominent female reformer in the country, from suffrage leaders like Anna Howard Shaw and Carrie Chapman Catt, the head of the major suffrage organization, to settlement workers like Jane Addams and many others. And a couple months later, there was a conference of women at The Hague, International Peace Conference, which Jane Addams was the chair of. This is a group of American delegates going over on a Dutch ship, neutral ship, the Noordam. Actually, they were stopped on the way to The Hague by British ships, and they were searched, and they were about to be turned back. And the U.S. ambassador to Great Britain was called out to help them, and he said, "I'm sorry, I'm not in favor of what you're doing, so I'm not going to help you." So it took them several days to get to the conference, but they managed to get there right before it began. And by the way, I got to stop myself from telling too many anecdotes, but one of the things Jane Addams did at this conference, Jane Addams was an internationally beloved figure among feminists and suffragists and people who were interested in, you know, social work and helping the poor. And a few Belgian women came to the conference and a few German women came to the conference too. And she made sure they would sit on both sides of her to symbolize, you know, that women, despite the fact that, of course, the Germans were occupying Belgium and there was a war going on, that they, women at least from these countries, were not going to be at war with one another. The Belgian woman actually denounced the German woman, so it didn't quite work. But symbolically, at least, it looked good. And the feminist critique of the war got into popular culture. The most popular piece of sheet music in America in 1915 was this song, actually written by a Canadian. "I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier." I should have queued up the YouTube of it. You can find it sung on YouTube with a video of the fighting. You know, back then, that's how you evidently found out what the popular songs were, but how many copies of sheet music were sold. 800,000 copies of sheet music were sold of this one song, and it was played, obviously, at halls around the country, bars perhaps, anywhere there was piano and other instruments. And it talks about international arbitration, and of course it depends on mothers to take the lead in stopping their boys from going to war. Same time, a group of prominent progressives and radicals are meeting regularly in New York City to form the American Union Against Militarism, included such well-known progressives as Lillian Wald, head of the Henry Street Settlement House, as important a settlement house as Hull House, the settlement house that Jane Addams set up in Chicago in the 1880s and 90s. Paul Kellogg, who was named, almost completely forgotten today, but he edited a magazine called The Survey, which was sort of a meeting ground for social reformers of various kinds, labor reformers, people who tried to pass a law outlawing child labor, also pacifists, you know, a whole really large spectrum of reformers at this time. And actually, Robert La Follette used to write for the magazine quite a bit as well. But also it included philanthropists like Amos Pinchot, who was the brother of Gifford Pinchot. You might have heard of the Interior Secretary under Theodore Roosevelt. Included Oswald Villard, who was Fanny Villard's son, who was the editor of the New York Post, a major newspaper in the big city. Rabbi Stephen Wise, who was a leader of Reformed Jews in the United States. And David Starr Jordan, the former president of Stanford University. So there was this was a sort of glittering group of, you know, what some people might call today bleeding heart liberals, but they were their heart was bleeding for millions of people dying in Europe, and they wanted the U.S. to stay out of it, and in fact the U.S. to take the lead in solving, settling the war, if at all possible. But it wasn't just, you know, upper middle class, wealthy, educated reformers who were part of this movement. Most union members, at least most union leaders, I should say, opposed preparedness and, of course, opposed going to war as well. Not just in 1914, but 1915 and 1916 as well. Samuel Gompers, leader of the American Federation of Labor, the leading labor organization in America, who was born in Britain, was much more ambivalent about this. But some of the major unions in America, the United Mine Workers Union, the Clothing Workers Union, the Textile Workers Union, the Ladies' Garment Workers Union, the butchers, most of the building trades locals, unions full of Germans and Poles and Irish Americans and German Americans and Russian Americans and others were opposed to the war, not just because they wanted to avoid ethnic tension, ethnic conflict within their union, so that was part of it. It's because they really believed that there was no reason for American workers to want to go overseas to fight other workers. Some were socialists, some were not, but to them, pacifism was a working class creed as well as a middle class creed. As the movement blossomed, it attracted powerful allies in Congress, including in Wilson's own party. I mentioned Claude Kitchen already, but one of the major figures in the party was this guy, William Jennings Bryan, who I wrote a biography about several years ago. Bryan was many things, as you know. He was a fundamentalist Christian, of course, famous or infamous, depending on your beliefs, by being a prosecutor in the Scopes trial in 1925. But before that, he was a major figure in moving the Democratic Party to the left. He was a proto-New Dealer in many ways, in terms of economic policy and social policy. And also, he was a lifelong pacifist. He was Secretary of State from 1913 to 1915, and continued to press Wilson at every point, trying to get Wilson to be neutral in deed as well as in word. He was very reluctant to support allowing J.P. Morgan to help the British, very reluctant to allow credits, the U.S. government to give credits to the British, even though he knew American workers are very happy that they were going back to work in factories making munitions and other war material. And he was the most popular figure in his own party, except for the president himself. And as most of you know, he resigned as Secretary of State after the Lusitania was torpedoed because he thought that Wilson's second note to the Germans was much too tough against the Germans. He thought that would bring the United States into the war. And he knew hardly anybody in his party wanted to go into the war. And I always mentioned, you know, ethnic animus on different sides. There were often meetings like this kind in New York and other cities that were full of immigrants and the children of immigrants. Mass meetings, and this is pretty late in the game. This is February 8th, a week after the Germans have already resumed unrestricted U-boat warfare. Calling for, as the title of my book has it, a war against war. Notice English, Yiddish, Russian, Italian, and others. There were many other languages spoken. So there were many, there's a large support network, if you will, for the activists in the anti-war party. And their tactics were quite diverse and quite imaginative, I think. They circulated petitions all over the country. That's you might expect them to do. But they also packed urban arenas like Madison Square Garden for protest rallies on a regular basis. They ran peace candidates for state and federal office, including Morris Hillquit, as I mentioned, during the war. And one of their most daring, perhaps, efforts in terms of tactical efforts happened after February 2nd, 1917, when many people just assumed the U.S. was going to get into the war by this point. They said, we don't think most Americans want to get into the war. Let's hold a referendum. If those who want the U.S. to get into the war, like Theodore Roosevelt, like Elihu Root, a leading Republican, like many people in the Republican Party, and some Democrats as well, if they want to get into the war so badly, ask the people if they want to get into the war or not. And they, different anti-war congressmen and senators held referenda in their own districts, their own states, which not surprisingly showed huge majorities against getting into the war. This, of course, was not constitutional. There's nothing in the Constitution that says the people have to be consulted before the U.S. goes to war. Of course, Congress has the power to declare war, or these days, the president usually has the power, unless Congress stops him. But it was interesting, they had confidence that if a referendum was held, an advisory referendum, obviously, wouldn't have been constitutionally binding, wouldn't have been legally binding, that that would have held off the U.S. declaring war. This is in February, when, you know, if you look at the newspapers, you know, in the exhibit here, across the walkway there, from February and March, a nice display of newspapers from early 1917, all the headlines saying, U.S. going to war, U.S. going to war, in February, before there was even a debate in Congress about it. So this was, in some ways, the last-ditch attempt. And also one should say that in 1916, when it seemed like Wilson was still on the side of the anti-war movement, the anti-war cause, wanted to keep the U.S. neutral, the anti-war movement did something that was surprising to many people. They supported Wilson, almost to a man and woman. And that included the Socialist Party, which had always run its own candidates before this. Eugene Debs had run four times for president, 1900 to 1912. He didn't run. The Socialists had a candidate, much less known, got many fewer votes, and as many of you know, and this is my 1916 anecdote for the lecture, perhaps, I'll have a few others as I go on. Charles Evans Hughes would have won the election in 1916 if he'd won California, even though he would have won only a minority of the popular vote. There were 3,776 votes separating, maybe four, I forget, separating Wilson from Hughes in California. That means if Hughes had gotten roughly 1,900 votes more than Wilson, he would have won California. And one of the intriguing counterfactuals to ask is, what would have happened if Hughes had been elected? Would the U.S. still have entered the war? If it had, would most Democrats have supported him the way most Democrats did support President Woodrow Wilson, who was, of course, from their own party? Counterfactuals, historians aren't supposed to ask those questions, but some counterfactuals are worth asking, because 1,900 votes, you know, it's like, what would have happened if Ralph Nader had not campaigned in Florida in 2000, getting 93,000 votes, which Al Gore only needed 530 more votes to win Florida, as you know. Would the U.S. have gone to war in Iraq? You know, counterfactuals like that are, I think, worth asking, even though some historians will yell at me for saying that. And it's also worth saying that, you know, among the prominent Americans who supported this peace coalition was this guy, Henry Ford, the most popular industrialist, not just in America probably, but in the world, because he made the automobile affordable, you know, to the masses, the Model T. Henry Ford charters his own ocean liner in 1915 to transport himself and dozens of other activists over to Europe. And I see I'm going on far too long about all this, so I'm going to, you know, speed up a little bit. What motivated those who opposed both preparedness and going to war? This is a more complicated question than I have time to go into the complications of, but also a more interesting one. Two types of arguments, I think. they made. The first was quite radical. That is, as I said before, they wanted a peaceful world. They were pacifists, which didn't mean they opposed all uses of violence, but it meant they opposed all wars. They were not against the police. They were not in favor of, you know, people not fighting back when they get beaten up, you know, which most people think pacifism means now. They were opposed to going to war, pretty much any war. But they thought preparing for war would make more war likely. They said, look what happened in Europe. You know, the Germans and Russians and the British, they all, and the French all, you know, built up their militaries because they were afraid of what would happen if they didn't, and guess what happened? They went to this terrible war. They said preparing for war makes war more likely, and peace, a peaceful world, less likely. But the second argument was kind of defensive, almost conservative. That is, they said, and this is a cartoon by a radical about it, but it has a perhaps a more conservative meaning to it in some ways. That is, the idea that Uncle Sam, as America and as the symbol of the U.S. government as well, of the American state, will just get bigger and bigger. That if the U.S. goes to war, we will be Prussianized. That term is used by people in the anti-war coalition all the time. Do you want a war in which, do you want a society in which, you know, income taxes have to be increased tremendously to pay for the war? Do you want a society in which people are put in jail for opposing the war, which of course happened once the U.S. does go to war? So many people argue that opposing the war was a conservative cause. William Stone from the state of Missouri, the Senate chair of the Foreign Relations Committee, as I mentioned, explained his decision to vote against the war this way. He said, I won't vote for this war because if we go into it, we will never again have the same old republic. That's a conservative sentiment. So you have here someone who says, you know, the government will get too big, I'm opposed to big government, I'm a Jeffersonian, like William Stone was, allying with socialists, like Morris Hillquit, allying with Southern racist Democrats, like Claude Kitchen, progressive Republicans, like Robert La Follette, anarchists, like Emma Goldman. It was quite a coalition. Well, obviously they lost. If we had public opinion polls back then, who knows what would have happened? I mean, if it's like this year, we would have had 50 public opinion polls all disagree with one another. So it would have been a little difficult to know. But many historians argue, people like John Milton Cooper, people like the great historian, biographer of Woodrow Wilson, Arthur Link, argue that the two sides were pretty evenly matched by March and early April 1917. The big newspapers, as you see downstairs or across the way in the exhibit, were big city newspapers were almost all in favor of going to war. But it's not clear that the people were, at least a large number of the people. Well, the U.S. does go to war, and once it does, what William Stone said, predicted, feared would happen, in many ways does happen. Randolph Bourne, intellectual, wrote for the New Republic and other magazines at the time, man was born with a hunchback, died of the Spanish flu in 1918, made the famous statement, one of his essays against the war, war is the health of the state. And I think that's indisputable, no matter whether you think the U.S. should have gone into the war or not, retrospectively. And one of the reasons why the Espionage Act was passed, the Sedition Amendments, which were amendments to the Espionage Act, was passed a year later, which, you know, you all know about, the repression against anti-war newspapers, anti-war speakers like Eugene Debs, is not because Wilson was paranoid or Congress was paranoid. It's because there was a real danger of all these Americans who opposed the war continue to oppose the war once the U.S. goes into it. So even though this was the most repressive act by the U.S. government against its opponents in U.S. history, it was in some ways a very rational thing to do. Because there was a real danger, not just of disrupting the war effort, not just of people continuing to speak out against the war, but also of disrupting conscription, disrupting the draft. And in fact, again, one conception people have, and you see all these pictures downstairs of young men lining up dutifully, you know, to register for the draft and then going into the war and being gung-ho for the war, not time to talk about all of that. But one thing people often miss is that the draft was not all that popular. In fact, 3 million men who were eligible for the draft never bothered to register at all. And 350,000 of them, more than 10%, either did not report as required or deserted from their training camps. Black Americans were overrepresented among those. They often felt, why should I fight, you know, for this war, that when we're not getting freedom at home? But also white small farmers, the kind of people Kitchen represented in North Carolina, also did. They often thought, as they often said, this is a rich man's war and a poor man's fight. And they felt no reason to help that fight. And there was a large group of people who tried to get out of the draft legally through conscious objection and were not able to. And there was a movement which got started to defend them. In fact, the American Civil Liberties Union was formed during World War I by radicals, originally called the National Civil Liberties Bureau. Chris Leisman was one of the founders of it, together with Roger Baldwin. And their only task was to defend people who were persecuted for opposing the war. They went on to do other things after that, of course. Well, I want to leave room for questions. So let me just say, what did it benefit the United States to enter the war? This is an important question. What did it benefit the world, for the U.S. to enter the war? Obviously, there was no peace without victory, as Wilson had grandly and naively demanded. As we know, the settlement made at Versailles did not last. U.S. Senate did not ratify the treaty. U.S. did not enter the world, the League of Nations. Wouldn't have made a difference if the U.S. had. That's debatable. But I think it's, and this is perhaps the most controversial thing I'll say, it's a terrible irony, I think, that the U.S. choice to intervene in World War I, I think it was a choice, there was no reason why the U.S. had to enter that war in terms of self-interest, may have made the Second World War more likely. The historian John Coogan writes, "It was the genius of Woodrow Wilson to recognize that a lasting peace must be a peace without victory. It was the tragedy of Woodrow Wilson that his own unneutrality would be a major factor in bringing about the decisive Allied victory that made a healing peace impossible." So we can discuss whether the peace coalition was right to oppose preparedness and to oppose the war, but I think the stakes of it losing were very great. Thank you.
Did the peace coalition then oppose U.S. entry into the League of Nations after the war?
That's a good question. They were split. Brian did. Brian actually supported the war once the U.S. declared war, but did not until a day before the vote in the House. He was opposing it. But Kitchen supported it. La Follette supported it. I mean, they thought, let's try to get the best out of this mess that we can, I think. And of course, most Democrats supported it anyway because it was Wilson's. You know, it became a very partisan issue. As you know, some Democrats opposed it, but and by that time also the Republicans controlled the Senate. They'd won the control of the Senate in 1918 election, so that meant that they were sort of fighting on the defensive. And also, they knew that Wilson, of course, was a sick man by the time the votes really took place. So even those who opposed it, you know, for partisan reasons, couldn't really oppose it. They would have been seen as stabbers in the back of their president, I think, if they had. But, you know, they would have. Brian, I think, who's often seen as a sort of not a very smart guy or something, or just an empty rhetorician, he wrote some interesting articles basically saying, you know, Mr. President, this is how you can compromise and still get your League of Nations. And, of course, Wilson was not hearing any of it.
Our next speaker is on this side.
Thank you. How significant, in terms of getting the U.S. into the war, was the Zimmerman telegram, or was that just icing on the cake, and if it hadn't happened, the U.S. probably still would have been in the war?
Again, a counterfactual, but, you know, the Zimmerman telegram, was there a stupider diplomatic move ever made? I don't know. I mean, as you know, as we just heard before, you know, the British read the cables, you know. Amazing. But I guess, you know, if you spent your youth dueling, you know, and had a scar on your face from your duels, as Zimmerman had, you know, you feel like you can get away with anything. You know, There's different opinions of this. Barbara Tuchman, my relative, wrote a book about that, which argued it was really essential. More recent historians, however, I forget the name of the one I cited in the book, I have to look at my footnotes, argues that really newspaper opinion didn't change very much. Newspapers who were in favor of it, U.S. getting in war before the Zimmerman telegram, were still in favor of it. Those who were opposed were still opposed. It didn't seem to move public opinion all that much, in part because it just seemed so outrageous, so outlandish. I mean, how are the Mexicans going to help the Germans? You know, it didn't make much sense, much less get the Japanese somehow get to California. So it made no sense. It just showed perhaps how desperate the Germans were.
You kind of touched on this by mentioning J.P. Morgan Jr. The slogan was, we went to war to keep the world safe for democracy. But sometimes, from things I've read and heard, it seems like maybe we went to war to keep the American bankers and financiers safe from financial ruin if the British and French lost.
Yeah, I get that question a lot, of course. I will get it more once the book comes out. Obviously, J.P. Morgan wanted to keep doing good business, and bankers who loaned money to the British wanted to get their money back to the French. But I think, I'm not an economic determinist. I don't think economic reasons are the main reason people support a war or oppose the war. And that certainly wasn't true for Wilson. I mean, there's no evidence that Wilson really cared about that. Colonel House, at times, in his diary, talked about it. But really, it was a question of whether the U.S. could lead the world better by leading the world towards peace and staying at peace, or whether it could lead the world better by getting to the war and making a difference in the war. And of course, Wilson believed in the end, in the latter, I think. Clearly the U.S. was doing fine economically without getting to the war, too. I mean, that's the other thing. If the British and French had lost the war, who knows? You know, if the Germans had been able to construct Middle Europa, construct really a much larger empire the way they obviously wanted to, who knows what would have happened. But as it was, the U.S. economy was doing fine, in terms of the percentage of American, GDP based on that money was, based on the loans, it was pretty small. So, Nall Ferguson's book, Pity of War, goes into some of this, I think. I disagree with Ferguson on a lot of things, like his great love for Henry Kissinger, but I think that's actually a very smart book, I think, about the economic stakes of the war. And of course, if you read the book, I don't know if people have read that book, it's a very long book, came out in the late 1990s, he asks this wonderful counterfactual question. He says, what's the worst that would have happened if the British and French had lost the war? Well, we might have this large, very prosperous, pretty democratic state right in the middle of Europe, be able to determine the policies of the European Union, which they control. Oh, we have that. it's called Germany. So I don't know if that's right. Again, counterfactuals. But when you write a book like this about a very large, I think influential and somewhat overlooked peace coalition, which may have had a majority of Americans on its side. And certainly seemed to at least be holding the National Security League and Theodore Roosevelt and some of those who wanted the U.S. to go to war at bay, and also was able to stop the military from being expanded very much until the U.S. does declare war. You can't avoid these counterfactual questions, because you do keep wondering, okay, so if they'd done this, if they'd done that, what would have happened? I don't dwell on that in my book. That's not good history to dwell on that, but again, 1,900 votes. What would have happened if Charles Evans Hughes had been elected as a winning minority of the popular vote? That's a question worth asking, I think.
Thank you. Your next question will come from Dr. Stagner.
I had a question. I wondered if you could comment on the sort of longer anti-war movement in terms of the American-Philippine War. I know Jane Addams was involved in that anti-war movement as well. Were some of these individuals the same? Were their tactics as they approached the First World War the same or different? How did that kind of evolve?
Yeah, that's a great question. In fact, if I had time, I would have gone into the whole question of why even though America's been at war for most of the years of our history, one way or another, why anti-war movements sort of don't get much coverage by historians. You can count on one hand, really one hand, the good books on anti-war movements in all of American history. Some people changed their views. Samuel Gompers was in the Anti-Imperialist League. And he was something of a pacifist at the time. And he opposed that the Spanish American was supposed to take the Philippines, and of course did not oppose going to World War I. William James, the great philosopher and psychologist who actually wrote an essay I begin my book with, The Moral Equivalent of War, the first sentence of which talks about the war against war. He died in 1910, but he certainly was a sort of icon for the pre-war peace movement, which I didn't have time to talk about, but which was pretty extensive and led by often elite figures like him from legal community, academia, so forth. Other figures, socialists weren't very strong in the 1890s. But Bryan was, even though he was in the army, had his own regiment, Nebraska Volunteers, which tried to get to Cuba, but he was actually in Florida the whole time. The war ended before he got there. He was very much against the conquest of the Philippines. In fact, the 1900 campaign, his second campaign for president, one of the major issues was anti-imperialism. So that's some examples. But you really can't talk about a long anti-war movement in the same way because, first of all, of course, the conquest of the Philippines, you know, most Americans barely aware it was going on, I think. It wasn't on the front pages very often. There was not a, you know, really large, sustained movement that was against it all the way until the war against the insurrectionaries, as they were called in the Philippines, finally was over in 1903 or so. And also because there were so many more different groups who were part of this movement, as I mentioned. Feminists were not particularly active, for example, in the movement against the conquest of the Philippines, whereas, of course, they were, as I said, sort of started this movement in many ways.
And our last question will come from this gentleman.
Hi, I'm a historian, and I work at Arlington National Cemetery, right across the river from you, where lies the grave of, as you said, the lifelong pacifist William Jennings Bryan. My question to you is, maybe not with La Follette, thank you. The other three individuals you talked about, do you know if there was did you find any evidence of correspondence or actual interaction between William Jennings Bryan and the other three?
Oh, yeah. Well, first of all, Kitchen and he were very close.
They were, okay.
Because Kitchen was this populist, racist Democrat. Those things went together at the time. Some may argue they still do, but I won't get into that. They were very close, a lot of correspondence between them. Kitchen, his speeches were often reprinted by the American Union Against Militarism. There's evidence that Eastman and Kitchen had meetings about strategy, trying to stop this preparedness bill and so forth, various other measures to try to stop the expansion of the military. La Follette and Kitchen, you know, correspondence between them as well. So yeah, there was a lot of, Hillquit, you know, being a socialist was a little anathema to some of them. But I should say that, again, socialists were not, you know, as we think, oh, socialists, communists, you know, they must have been way on the left flank. You know, there were a lot of socialists met with Wilson in the White House, for example, together with non-socialists who were against preparedness and against the war. So there was a lot of leakage, a lot of intersections between these people. In fact, at one point, really in early February, the last time Jane Addams goes to the White House to meet with Wilson, she pleads with him to try to forestall things, and Wilson says, "I don't think it's going to happen, Jane." She didn't say it like that. That's not what a Princeton professor says, but you know, but he basically said it that way. And so, but up till then, he continued to sort of be ambivalent. And of course, the fact that the Senate Majority Leader was very much opposed to the war, was a pacifist, you know, he had to work with everybody who supported him. So, and Kitchen was also one of the 50 congressmen to vote against the war. I mentioned him because of that. So, I mean, just think of that. You have the House Majority Leader, the Chair of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, you know, both voting against going to war. So this show, and the most important progressive Republican in the Senate. They only got 6 votes against the war in the Senate and only 50 votes against in the House, but you know, people say if people voted their own conscience, more people would have voted against the war. So, thank you.
Thank you.